So welcome all to this second day of this workshop. So thank you so much, you know, for the first day. It was a very scintillating day. So today, you know, we are going to have a bit exhaustive day. I'm just going to talk about, you know, systems genomics in the age of next generation sequencing. So, you know, whenever we talk about systems genomics, you know, there are two aspects of it. One is what we call it as a system, which could be any kind of an you know, a kind of an organism in the system. Okay, it could be a bacteria, it could be you.
Prash, we are not hearing you. Prash, are you still there?
So.
Plus, you have to repeat last 1 minute.
Yeah, you know, somehow my internet connection is a bit unstable, Kiran. So can you please just drop me a message in WhatsApp if there is a problem? Yeah.
Sure, I do that.
Yeah, thank you. So if you really look into the realm of bioinformatics, I know, you know, many of you know very basics of bioinformatics. So the central dogma of molecular biology states that DNA transcripts mRNA translates to protein. Okay, so DNA is double-stranded, mRNA is single-stranded, and from the single-stranded mRNA, you can translate into a protein. And that is how, you know, you can get the function of it. But in principle, when you look into these entities, the DNAs, the mRNAs, the proteins, all the three biomolecules are nothing but the sequences. You know, they are enriched in the form of, you know, sequences. Okay. So sequence predicts structure, structure predicts the function. It's nothing but a central dogma of bioinformatics. Okay. So usually, you know, I always give a kind of a classical example for central dogma of bioinformatics. One is if you have, you know, pearl beads, and if you insert, you know, a small thread in between them, then you can use that particular beaded thread into a kind of an ornament, okay, as a kind of, you know, necklace or something like that, okay, or a bracelet or something like that. So imagine each of those particular pearls as A's, T's, C's, and G's, or the 20 amino acids. So if you really put them in an order, that particular structural entity can be deciphered, and that is how you can identify the function of it, okay. So sequence-based databases are many, there are plenty. So many of these particular databases are run through a lot of, you know, tools. The well-known tools you pretty well know, the BLAST. BLAST is a BLAST-like a basic local alignment search tool. FASTA is fast alignment. BLAT is BLAST-like alignment tool. Likewise, you know, there are proprietary databases like PrimoBLAST, where, you know, erstwhile, you know, primer sequences, you know, could be blasted. It's no longer there. So likewise, you know, you can use, you know, different databases. Likewise, there are genome browsers. The well-known genome browser is the University of California, Santa Cruz. There are also other well-known databases, databases that are run through these genome browsers. Other genome browsers like Ensemble, okay, which are more user-friendly, you know, can also be used. So having said this, if you take any protein sequence or a DNA sequence, so the best classical example, you know, to ascertain the function of any biomolecule is through protein. So usually the protein, you know, from your window, you have three domains, the N-terminal, the middle terminal, the C-terminal, okay? So usually many of these particular domains are present in the C-terminus because the C-terminus is that particular protein, you know, that allows the protein, you know, to enter the cell or to enter the organelle, okay? So many of these sequences are either conserved or unconserved, okay? So usually the domains are not really that conserved because they make up the larger sequences. But, you know, there are some short signature sequences in the form of motifs that are highly conserved all through the length and breadth of the protein, okay? So now a very important question as a biologist that you should understand is what if, you know, if there is no conservation? So the obvious thing is if there is no conservation, you get a lot of, you know, mutations or single nucleotide polymorphisms. Okay, so come next is the structural genomics. So as I told you, the sequence predicts structure, the structure predicts the function. So once you have the structures, many of these structures can be ascertained using different databases. Usually there are four important structures: the primary structure, the secondary structure, tertiary, and the quaternary. Primary structure is nothing but the very basic sequence entity. Secondary structure is just into folds. The tertiary structure is more rigorous folds, and the quaternary structure is the superlative structure where it is crystallized. And that is how you can ascertain the function, and for which there are different databases. These structural databases can also be coalesced with the sequence databases as well, sequence-based BLAST as well, like something like the position-specific iterated BLAST, the pattern hit initiated BLAST, where you can check the patterns of signature sequences present across the length and breadth of the proteins. Okay. So and now the most important thing is, how do you ascertain the function? So once you have look into the crevices of those particular structure, you can probably identify a plausible ligand that can be complemented to that particular protein. Or maybe you can check whether or not those particular sequences or structures are present across the length and breadth of the genome. That's where your comparative genomics or comparative proteomics come into picture. So basically, you're comparing these sequences at the ultra-structural level, at the functional level as well. Okay, and that's where many databases like the HapMap project, the haplotype mapping project from humans, the Human Genome Project, way back it was started in 97, which was officially declared to be completed in 2003. Okay, all those kind of things came into picture. In case of plants, we've got the Grameen database and other stuff. So basically, whenever you talk about bioinformatics, the most important thing is what you call it as the holy grailing. Okay, so the holy grailing is nothing but you are trying to ascertain a function given the sequence that you have. Okay, so usually from the sequence predicts, structure predicts, functional entities, usually there are functions ascribed to that. So if there is a function that is ascribed from sequence structural relationship, that is what we call it as a normal or so-called a folded protein or an ordered protein. Okay, which means the protein is good, which is not absolutely bad, and from which you can ascertain the function. And what if if you have certain misfolds, sometimes where if you can see there are wrong knots that are present whenever you tie a knot. So if you want to remove those particular knots, sometimes there might be misfolding happening. Yeah, I can see that my connection is a bit bad. I apologize for this. Is it audible right now?
It's audible, Prashant. It's audible.
Yeah, good. Yeah. I'm sorry for this. Huh? So if at all, if there are misfolds, that's where, you might have some structural, crevices, that are, semi-interleaved or maybe, with misjoints. Such misfolds might really happen. That might result in a kind of a misfolded protein. But the orderliness of the entire protein might be altered if you think that you have an accurate sequence, but the structure for that particular accurate sequence might be unstructured, which means you are not trying to predict a good structure, for which you're not really getting a good function. So the disorderliness of that particular protein is ascribed to that. And that's where the real challenge for the disordered proteins are. And many of these disordered proteins still remain in the cell, and ascribing function to them has really become a Herculean task. So basically, what I'm just trying to tell you at this point of time is, whenever you have the sequences, there are many sequences, there are a plethora of sequences across the publicly available repositories. There are three main gene banks. One is the NCBI GenBank, the National Center for Biotechnology Information. The second one is the MBEL-EBI, the European Molecular Biology Laboratory, European Bioinformatics Institute in Kingston, and also in Heidelberg. And the third one is the DNA Data Bank of Japan, the DNA Data Bank of Japan, based in Osaka and Tokyo. Okay. So once we have all these kind of things, So what bioinformaticists are really striving to do is, can we really collate all these particular sequences, okay, and come something closer where we can ascertain a kind of a good structure to that. So once you have a kind of a so-called good structure, then you can identify a kind of a good function, okay. But if you really see the public level repositories, there are not more than 60,000 and odd structures for any of them. When the Human Genome Project was launched, many of those particular structures were not really bona fide. They were not really good. That's because many of those particular sequences were not available. Many of the genomes were not sequenced. So people used to rely on something called the express sequence tags or the serial analysis of gene expression, where the cDNA libraries from RNA was to be converted at that point of time. And those express sequenced small signature sequences were considered as the express sequenced tags, okay? So still, there are some inherent challenges for that. So that's where, this the Moore's law of DNA sequencing is. So the Moore's law states that the computing speed, doubles every year, whereas the cost of it, should in principle be reduced to half, okay? When there are computing capabilities that are increased, manifold, there are again challenges, that can really be, coalesced, taking into the analogy, the number of, the whole genome sequences that are published from time to time. So as of today, as you could see, there are so many, there are almost 100 billion sequences that are available, length and breadth of the genome. And yet, we are not really, trying to compete the most. Okay. And that has really, a very important question. Where are we really moving ahead? Are we really suffice with something called bioinformatics? Or are we really, in need of, new terminologies like, the big data and all those, kind of stuff, that we are trying to do? So this really begs into a very important question that I've really put up in the first slide. Okay, that's where this machine learning is really taking a wonderful picture. Okay, so this cartoon, which I've adapted from a Facebook from Stat Guy, this lady is really lost into an island, and she collects some pebble stones and she writes "help" with those pebble stones, and none of those flights come to her rescue. But this lady, she's so intelligent that she writes, "I know machine learning." She gathers more pebble stones, and even you see the flights come to her rescue in emergency mode. Even the parachutes or paragliders come to her rescue. So that's the beauty of machine learning. That's what the wonderful talk from Sir yesterday, we have really dealt with. So there is an integration. There is a kind of an integration that is really needed. So we just need not really is sufficient with bioinformatics as a tool, but systems sciences or systems biology as a discipline, we really need to move further. So that has really allowed bioinformatics to move up the value chain. Okay. So 1 minute, I'm just seeing if Nancy is here. Nancy, would you mind taking the attendance, please?
Yes, sir, I'm taking.
Yeah, thank you. So. So that is how the bioinformatics has really moved up the value chain. So if you really look into the systems biology, the one of the most important or fascinating fields with systems biology is, as I told you, the systems and the interactions. So a system is usually a non-living entity, but it could be a living entity in the form of an organism like human beings. Okay. So if you really take the body parts of a car, they're all a system. So they're all assembled together. And that's where, you find a lot of, car parts assembled together. But if you really remove one particular tiny bolt, the function of the car might be altered. The same way, you've got, the major components that are, coalesced together in case of our human system. And all these particular coalesces are interconnected to each other in the form of major components and minor components. Major components are those particular components in the form of heart, lung, all those particular tissues. The minor components are nothing but, you know, the biomolecules that are present in these particular cells. And most essentially, like the major components that are interconnected to each other, the minor components are also interconnected to each other. Okay, they are not just interconnected, but they also interact. Okay, they know the language. You know, if there is a particular protein which has a function, and if this is a particular protein which doesn't have any function, this particular protein, you know, tries to, you know, connect to that. Okay, and then this unknown protein can take the function of this known protein. So that's the beauty of, you know, the wonderful exchange, you know, with these small biomolecules, you know, that are, you know, taking place within the system. Okay. So we really need to learn a lot, you know, as a human, you know, these tiny, they take, you know, to a wonderful rescue. My PhD was, you know, something fascinating, you know, there was, there is no DNA mismatch repair system in mitochondria. As you know, mitochondria has got only 32 protein coding genes. You know, not all proteins are really present in the mitochondria, being a tiny organelle. Okay, but there is a DNA mismatch, you know, that is going on in mitochondria. Now, what happens is, you know, a protein sitting outside the mitochondria, somewhere in the cytoplasm, you know, makes an SOS call or receives an SOS call from the mitochondria. Okay, and does the repair, goes inside the mitochondria. Okay. And again, you know, it comes back. Okay. So that is the beauty of it. You know, this is what we call it as, you know, piggybacking mechanism. Okay. And in 2019, Moldrick et al, you know, they won the Nobel Prize for this, you know, for the DNA mismatch repair system that was discovered, you know, 30 years ago. Okay. You see, this is all, you know, interconnections. But having said this, within these interconnections, within the organism, there is always an influence on how this organism is really living in the environment. Okay, that is absolutely a kind of a very, very important entity. And the best example is the SARS-CoV-2. You see, it has become, you know, so intelligent that, you know, when the humans started coming out, the virus, you know, started attacking, you know, the children, because, you know, children are inside. Okay. Earlier, you know, it was believed that, you know, the children has got, you know, a very good, you know, alveolar fluid. It wouldn't really hurt them. But now you see, you know, new strains have really, you know, come into picture. There are mutations, you know, that are arising and falling. There are strains, you know, adapting and unfitting in the environment. And there are proteins that are evolving and devoluting. And sometimes, who knows, there are genes, you know, that are lost and formed. So basically, systems biology is a biology of system. It was lost into oblivion once, okay? And it's not really a kind of a new, discipline as we really think. So basically, you know, these are all the contexts in the systems. Okay, a context is nothing but an ohm. Ohm is nothing but, as I told you, many. Okay, so whenever you say genome, study of many number of genes is nothing but genomes. Okay, and when you say proteome, study of many number of proteins. Transcriptome, study of many number of transcripts, and so on and so forth. So these contexts are specific for, you know, different types of organisms. So whenever you take plants, there are stress-related traits, there are quantitative trait loci, there are genes, okay? So these define, you know, that particular entities in plants. But as in animals, you know, there are some overfeeding traits. The cow is really overfed, you know, to probably, you know, giving, you know, more milk, you know. The buffaloes are overfed, you know, so that, you know, it can give, you know, good, you know, buffalo milk. Okay, they're overgrazed. You know, that efficiency is absolutely, you know, very important. Likewise, there are bacteria. Okay, so as bacteria, you know, there are multi-isolate, mono-isolate, pathogenic, non-pathogenic, host-specific, host-interface, okay, host-non-specific, and all those kind of things. But we humans are the strong contenders, because we are wonderful entities where, you know, we try to, you know, interact with the environment. That's where, you know, the epigenetic variables are, okay? We try to look into the various, you know, diseased conditions, okay? A person who is probably obese, we don't call obesity as a disease, okay? Obesity is a phenotype that is associated with type 2 diabetes, okay? See, that's the beauty of, you know, we humans. So we tend to interact with, you know, environment and try to ascertain, you know, the influence of those particular variables in the form of context across the system. So if you really see, this particular contention might really be attributed to a lot of, you know, true positives, true negatives, false positives, and false negatives. Okay. So this is what systems genomics is. So as I told you, genomics is nothing but study of many number of genes. So we need to integrate a lot of data sets. We try to understand all the omissions, then validate those particular things, probably using the wet lab based approaches, taking the bioinformatics knowledge, and then, you know, we apply the function, you know, to those particular things. So likewise, if you really talk about humans, you know, we are a bit selfish. I'm also a bit selfish for that, you know, I'm a human. So I would largely talk about, you know, the human genomics here. You know? So whenever we talk about, the omes or omissions, one of the well-known entities that we always talk is the human genome is about 3.2 billion base pairs for a haploid data set. And for diploid, it's about 6.4 billion base pairs. Okay. And now each of these particular entities make up about 10,000 proteins per cells. And these proteins per cells are different across, you know, different conditions. Okay. And they make up, different cells across, you know, different conditions. And please bear it in mind that all the 20,853 genes need not really make the precise 10,000 proteins in the cells, okay? So, but at the end of the day, they make, you know, an approximate, you know, 1,000 pathways per cells, okay? And that is where, you know, the spatio-temporal entity might really take place, okay? So we might really want to check whether or not certain proteins are differentially expressed or constitutively expressed. When you say differentially expressed, across different conditions, maybe a person, you know, from Jammu who might be associated with temperatures, you know, less than 25 degrees all through the year, might have certain differentially expressed proteins across the length and breadth of his or her genome. Okay. Whereas a person like me who is in Jaipur, where we experience 47, 48, we might be associated with certain conditions where, you know, we have in extremities. We have extreme winter as well, you know, sometimes the temperature, you know, goes to 1.5 or 2 as well. But there are certain genes that do not alter the expression, okay? They are inherent across the length and breadth of the genome, like that. Can someone tell me what are those particular genes? Yeah. Yeah, please. Can someone tell me what are those genes that do not change all through the length and breadth of the genome at any given point of time? Yeah, please. Hello, am I alone?
Are they conserved genes?
Yeah, sorry. Yeah.
Conserved genes?
No, not really. Yeah.
Some of the participants written housekeeping genes also.
Wonderful. Yeah, just... wonderful. Yeah. Oh, sorry. I did not notice the chat box. Yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah. So I'll keep in mind, you know. Yeah. So yeah, exactly. The housekeeping genes. Okay. So this is perfect, you know. So yeah, thank you. So those are all the, you know, the so-called the housekeeping genes. But in any case, at any given point of time, across the length and breadth of the cell cycle, you find certain proteins that are altering the expression. So checking what are those particular proteins in relation to the housekeeping genes as control, that is where, you know, these spatio-temporal interactions can be checked, for which, you know, various databases like this now can be used, you know, profusely. So that begs us a very important question, you know, where is this, you know, leading to? What's big, you know, why big for systems genomics? Okay. What are the implications, you know, for, you know, cell science? So just imagine we have got one of these particular trillion cells has got a nucleus as a genetic material and also mitochondria also having the genetic material. Okay. So across the 6.4 billion base pairs of human genome, you get all this in a relative expression, you know, from time to time. So you need a big data space, you know. That's where, you know, this machine learning and all those, you know, big data leverages, you know, can really be understood. That's where, you know, Sundartha will try to explain you next week. So at any given point of time, we are limited by data analysis. There's a data deluge. There's a huge set of, you know, data, plethora of data. We really don't know how to do that. We really need to cut short and come up with a precise knowledge from that, and a good testable hypothesis from which, you know, big data that we have can be jotted down to smaller, meaningful data, like the leukemia data, you know, that Sir was explaining, you know, with a good accuracy. Okay, so we need those particular tools with less bias, and we need, you know, a predictive analytic based approaches, you know, to counter these kind of things. So how to approach this? So we need probabilistic models, and these probabilistic models, you know, can be associated with a compendium of various expression data, and they vary from one organism to the other. Not necessarily that, you know, we have found, you know, one probabilistic model for humans. That particular probabilistic model can probably be used, you know, for savants or, you know, other eutherians or other, you know, eukaryotes. That may not be there. Maybe that organismal system might be varying because the epigenetics varies, because the genomic variation varies. Okay. So in order to check that, we need a reference repository. So that's where, you know, we need a reference genome. So for every organism, that's one of the reasons why we have a reference genome, you know, for those particular, you know, genera. Okay. So that plays a very important role. So for that, you know, you can use, you know, huge databases, huge data sets. One of the well-known data sets, you know, for which you can explore is galaxyproject.org or usegalaxy.org. That Kiran Harpreet and Sangram, you know, would demonstrate tomorrow. But for systems biology, one of the well-known tools is the BioGrid, so which is the database of proteins and genetic interactions. That's where, you know, it's largely used. There are, of course, you know, other databases, you know, that are, you know, sparsely used, you know, nowadays, you know, for this. So the first part of my talk is, you know, we need to bring, you know, bioinformatics and systems genomic approaches. There are some inherent challenges. There is a need for consortiums. So if you're working on, say on cancer genetics, you know, please don't think that, yes, you know, I'm doing my research, I really don't want to, you know, keep that particular research, you know, to myself. Okay, maybe you can try to collaborate with your, you know, with your, you know, collaborator. That's where, you know, collaborations are the key, not the competitions or the competence. Especially during the post-COVID times, okay? You cannot say that, yes, no, I've done some work, you know, I'll be doing my own work, okay? Then you're falling into the grave. The best example is the COVID. Over the last 16 months, several discoveries have really taken shape in COVID, okay? All the discoveries are really going down. They're all really going bad because we've got new strains. Because we are thinking of even towards, you know, biowarfare as well. We really don't know, you know, what's really happening. Okay, so we need consortiums. The best well-known consortium that first people have started was the FIND, the Functional Annotation of Animal Genomes. And of course, whenever you try to work on these proteins or genes, annotation and curation is not the key. You also look into the spatiotemporal interactions and of course the beta pipelines. But in systems biology and systems genomics, as I told you, you always need to understand what are these particular proteins that are doing and interacting with each other. But in order to know, you need to really peep into the genome, okay? So you really need to look into the genomic space and see what exactly these particular, you know, bases heralding the genes or the amino acids heralding the proteins are really doing. And for that, you need the next generation sequencing, okay? That is the rationale behind why, you know, the next generation sequencing is started. So any quick questions for the very first, 30 minutes of the talk? I'll be happy to answer. Yeah.
So I have a question.
Yeah, please.
So can you please explain the reference genome again? Is it the kind of a standard sequence or something that we can compare? Is it like that?
I'll slowly come in detail to that, but just to answer your quick question, a reference genome is nothing but a genome for your organism where it is well annotated and curated. So which means, you know, several organisms, the best example is in case of humans, where the Human Genome 1000 Genome Project was launched. They sequenced about 2,650 genomes across the length and breadth of the world. Okay, they have taken Telugu population, Tamil population, UP, Punjab, Kannadiga, Maharashtrian, Rajasthani, from India as well. Okay, and from various places as well. And they built a kind of a consensus map for that. Okay, that is what we call it as a reference map. Okay, so so this reference map is a conglomerate of all these particular genomes, preferably the human genomes that we are really talking about, and see what are those particular bases that are altered across the length and breadth of it. Okay. And then, of course, you downstream or proprietary databases. Of course, as you rightly pointed out, the very first 1000 genome project, or when the reference genome was first made earlier, it was, through the Sanger sequencing or the deoxyribonucleic acid sequencing. That's the first generation. Okay, but we are really looking into the so-called fourth generation sequencing now. Okay, which we call it as the now generation sequencing or the next generation sequencing. So I hope that clears your question, KK.
Yeah. Yes.
I have one basic bioinformatics question. That is, what is the difference between annotation and curation?
Yeah. So annotation is, you are just eating one chocolate and saying that, yes, the chocolate is very good. Okay. But curation is you are eating 10 chocolates and then you are saying that, yes, the chocolate is, out of those 10 chocolates, this chocolate is very good. Okay, so which means annotation is simply annotating and coming up with the very first time information on what this particular sequence does relative to the function. Okay, but when you look into the curation, you're not really going back. Okay, you're not saying again, rechanging or re-paraphrasing your dialogue and saying that, yes, this is not this sequence. So when you say that KK is the king of Bangladesh, then you are sure that, yes, KK is the king of Bangladesh. You're not going back. Okay. You're not saying that KK is, say, the chief minister of Bangladesh. Okay. So he's the king of Bangladesh for good. Okay. So likewise, if you say that a protein is with these domains, then you are saying it for good. You're saying it for a complete sense that this particular protein does this particular function. That is curation. Okay. But annotation might invite a lot of errors. Okay.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. So, assuming that there are no more questions, I will quickly move and reserve our energies for hands-on. Okay. This is about the OM. OM, as I told you, OM is nothing but many. Okay. So the if you really see the dideoxyribonucleic acid, the AST, Cs, and Gs for the four bases across at least 50 bases to be read, it used to take almost 1 hour. Okay. Cometh next generation sequencing. What happened was your DNA is really split into strands like this. Okay. So you've got the introns and exons. So the exons are nothing but the coding chunks and the introns are the non-coding chunks. So just like, the padmark that you keep for your notice board, okay? You can keep something like padmarks, for your strands as well, for your bases as well, okay? So imagine this is your sequence. So each of these particular DNA strands is broken down into equal lengths. In case of Illumina, Illumina is a short read sequencing instrument, so which splits anywhere between 50 bases to 500 bases. Okay, whereas in a long read sequencing like the PacBio, the Oxford Nanopore, or 10x, okay, you use something anywhere between 5,000 bases to 50,000 bases. The entire stretches of the genome are sequenced length and the breadth. Irrespective of that, what Illumina short read sequencing does is, imagine this is your sequence. So you are given something called linkers, you know, that are attached to the ends like this. Okay. So now these are nothing but, you know, some bookmarks, you know, that are kept at the end to identify what this 50 base or 100 base or 150 base sequence is. Okay. And apart from that, in between as well, there are some pug marks, you know, there are some pinholes, you know, that are pointed out. So those are nothing but the linkers and the adapters. Okay. Like this. You see, the linkers are usually at the end like this, the pink ones. And these are all the adapters, you know, that are length and breadth of those particular individual similar size strands, and they're hybridized. And this hybridization leads to the target enrichment. And then the linkers are removed, okay? Linkers are nothing but the synthetic bases, okay? Those do not alter your, you know, the way, you know, the genome is sequenced, okay? And finally, you get the A's, T's, C's, and G's, okay? That is how, you know, your sequencing is read. And now what happens is when you are splitting your sequence like this, you get a lot of, you know, sequences, right? Which means similar size sequences. But in order to have these similar size sequences, you need to enrich your targets, isn't it? So you need to copy these number of sequences. So for that, you can use a simplest polymerase chain reaction, or you can use something called DGS, the direct genome selection, or hybrid capture based methods, a simplest inversion probes, which means if this is a sequence, it is tilted like this, and the sequence is read from right to left. That is what we call it as the inversion probes. Okay. Of course, you know, these target enrichment or library preparation, you know, differs from one sequencing instrument to the other sequencing instrument.
Prash, mute, pause yourself. You're not able to hear, not audible.
So you can also look into something called...
Prash, can you repeat last 1 minute? We couldn't hear last 1 minute.
Yeah. That is what I thought, so I'm just going back. So Illumina is a short-read sequencing chemistry prototype, whereas, you know, 10x or PacBio or Oxford Nanopore, you know, is nothing but in a long-read sequencing chemistry. Okay. And it depends, you know, there are different entities like the depth of the coverage, the target size, the sample of sequencing run, and all those kind of things. I'll try to tell you, you know, during the next few slides. But usually the latest instrument is the NovaSeq and the NextSeq, you know, for Illumina, which can sequence the entire human genome in less than, you know, 3 hours. Okay, that's the beauty of it, you know. So for which, you know, you get raw reads. So whenever you isolate your DNA from your genome, okay, you'll ask the sequencer to sequence the genome, and you are provided with raw reads. And these are mapped to the reference, okay. And then you mark the duplicates, and then you try to check for the analysis, and then you try to see what are the mutations or SNPs that are present across. And then you use, you know, different tools and databases, you know, some of those particular databases and tools now we will try to use. So there are different pipelines depending on the type of sequencing. What is the
Can you please explain depth of sequence?
Yes. I'm just coming to the attention, please. So please, I'll just know that. So sorry. So so there are different, you know, pipelines, you know, different pipelines are used, you know, for different entities. Okay. Of course, there are commercial pipelines like PARTEC, QIAGEN, CLC Bio, Interpretomics. Okay, well-known, you know, pipelines are like the genome analysis toolkit, the SecMule, the OPEX, the Impact. Okay, these are all the well-known tools. But this looks, you know, very sturdy and very complicated sometimes. although the genome analysis toolkit is used by 76% of the users. And there are online cloud-based things like Galaxy, Tavexa, and Taverna. Taverna is precisely used by Indian counterpart. Galaxy is the one based in Johns Hopkins, which Kiran will be able to demonstrate tomorrow. And then, you know, bioinformatics is always, you know, to reach consensus. You're not saying that, yes, you have run one tool and you got the results, okay? You need to use one or two more tools, or at least benchmark your pipeline, and then reach consensus, and then come up to a conclusion that, yes, your results are something, you know, similar, okay? So usually the next generation sequencing reads are usually in the form of FASTQ reads. FASTQ is fast quality, okay? The erstwhile Sanger sequencing tools are in the form of, you know, reads are in the form of FASTA, okay? Fast alignment. Now the Oxford Nanopore technology reads are in the form of, you know, FASTQ5, okay? So there are, you know, different parameters. So once you get the FASTQ files, they're processed across different tools, okay? So what happens is usually your sequence, you know, in order to know that your sequence is impromptu to that particular organism. So what you basically need to know is you need to map it to your that reference, okay? Then you see if that your sequence is exactly matching to your reference or not, okay? Then you might ask me a very important question. Okay, what if you don't have a reference genome? Okay, so if you don't have a reference genome, there's something what we call it as a de novo based approach. Okay, so a de novo based approach comes in the form of a kind of a fast approximation or a greedy based algorithm, where the sequence itself, you know, comes up with some approximations or heuristics and comes to a conclusion that, you know, this itself, you know, could be the region, you know, to that particular matchable area. And this could probably be this region where that can be again mapped to a database. Okay, so such sequencing is called as a de novo sequencing. Okay, or de novo annotation. Okay. And then you come up with various tools. You generate something called SAM. SAM is a sequence alignment mapping. Okay, for which there are two important tools. One is Bauti and HiSeq2, which I'll try to explain. Of course, there are other tools like the Burrows Wheel Aligner, okay, the Soap Snip Snap, okay. There are other tools, you know, that are used length and breadth. I'll just try to tell you during the next slides. Usually, the FASTQ files are very high, you know, pretty heavy, pretty big in size. So you need to convert into SAM, and then you need to convert into binary file. That binary file is called binary alignment mapping, or the BAM file. Usually when you have it, in case of the eukaryotes, not all these particular sequences are in the alphabetical order of the chromosomal positions. So you need to sort them. So that sorting is called as the sort BAM file, okay? And then you will call the variants in case of whole genome sequencing or whole exome sequencing. And that's where, you know, the variant calling format, you know, comes into picture, okay? And then you can visualize. So what happens is, so once you have a genome like this, usually the sequence can be read, the instrument reads like this from 5' to 3'. If it is oriented only from one direction, it is called as single end chemistry or single read chemistry. If it is a paired end, it is read one to end from 5' to 3' and 3' to 5'. The other read is from the reverse direction, okay? And if the lab is rich, you can reach multiple consensus. You can say several single reads and several, you know, reverse reads. Okay, that is what we call it as a mate pair reads, the MP read chemistry or the mate pair read chemistry. This usually, so far, only 3 or 4 labs have really done. Unless, you know, your lab is rich, unless you think that, you know, you have a lot of money, you know, to be exploited for, you know, consensus, then you can go for mate pair chemistry. And of course, once your data is done, once you get the reads, you're not ending the story, because you need to check the quality of it, whether or not the sequencing is done impromptu properly, whether or not you have got the linkers, you know, trimmed properly, whether or not the linkers are not really a part of your sequence, okay? Whether or not your sequence is not duplicated several times, okay? Whether or not your sequencing as high quality reads. That high quality reads is well known using something what we call it as the FRET score. Okay, or the FRET is nothing but a score. A score above 30 is always nice, and above 25 is also okay, but sometimes it is mediocre. Okay, so this is what we need to really look into the thing, and that's where you know the depth and all you know comes into picture, you know, before the quality comes. So what is that depth? I'll just, you know, try to tell you during the next few slides. So before you understand the details of it, so in case of eukaryotes, as I told you, we're all the humans. So my talk is largely based on the human genome sequencing efforts. So usually in a human genome, you've got the exons, okay, and interconnected by introns like this, okay. So usually the exons were believed to be the only coding chunks, okay, and they were the only ones, you know, that would probably give something called expressibility or the function, okay. Nevertheless, it isn't so, okay. So what happens is there are some intronic chunks that are sitting somewhere here, very close to the exons, which make up the functional entities, you know, that of exons as well, okay. So based on the type of orientation or the read or the exact position that you really wanted to deliver, there are four types of, you know, sequencing approaches. One is a whole genome sequencing, which you take the entire read, both exons and introns. Whole exome sequencing, only you take the whole exons like this, okay. And whole transcriptome shotgun sequencing or RNA-seq, where you take RNA as a genetic material, reverse transcript to cDNA and check the expression, okay. And sometimes you really don't want to sequence the entire length and breadth of the genome. You really want to sequence only some parts of it, okay. Maybe one gene or chromosome one from this position to that particular position. That is what we call it as a targeted genome sequencing, which might constitute both exons and as well as introns. Okay, is that clear? So these are the four type of things. But sometimes, you know, there are people, especially the bacteriologists, they really want to know from the colony PCR whether or not that is the kind of organism that they really want to identify. You really don't know what kind of organism it is, say if an organism of interest is there in water, okay. So since the water is there in the environment, since there are many genomes associated with that, that kind of sequencing is called as metagenome sequencing, okay. So metagenome sequencing is nothing but those sequences that can be exploited across the length and breadth of the genomes in the environment. It can be preferably small bacteria, but in case of like mucormycosis now, it can also be, you know, because, you know, the fungal spores are very small. Okay, they infect, you know, the sinus and all those, you know, kind of things. Okay, is it clear, dear friends? Okay, this slide is very, very important, you know, until this particular thing. If you are clear until this particular point, then you will be able to do your exercises, you know, wonderfully. Okay, I'll just quickly pause for, 1 minute. If you have any quick questions, please. Yeah. I'll come to that point, you know, that you wanted. Yeah, please. Yeah.
Can you, I'm new to this, so can you please go back to the slide before the one which you talked about pipelines and just give me a, go a little slow and tell me what that was like. I mean, yeah.
This one?
Can you just explain that for me a little? The next one. Yeah, this also. Yeah.
Yeah, you know, what happens is, you know, you have, you know, several billion base pairs of the genome, right? So if you need to sequence it, you cannot sequence only one strand like this and then sequence it. So you need to make a multiple copy of that particular strand, okay? So what happens is, if you have this genome, you need to make multiple copies of that particular sequence, okay, like this. So you need to make several copies of this particular thing like this. And then you can reach consensus. So in order to make multiple copies, you can use PCR or inversion probes or direct genome selection. These are all the chemicals, okay? So these are all the chemical-based approaches to ensure that your strands are copied multiple number of times, okay? And then you can set it for sequencing, okay? So, and then you can use, you know, different tools. Usually, once you get the sequencing is usually read in the form of something called FASTQ files, okay? FASTQ is fast quality, okay? And then it is processed across, you know, different programs and tools, and then, you know, you can reach consensus. Okay. There are different pipelines, as I told you. Different pipelines are used, you know, for different purposes.
What do you mean by pipeline?
The FASTQ file is converted to.
What exactly is a pipeline?
Pipeline is nothing but, you know, set of tools that are passed, you know, from one result, you know, to the other result. Okay. So it's just like, you know, since you're a doctor, you know, you might be having a treatment regimen. So what if, you know, say dispirin doesn't work for a person? So can we probably, you know, go for something like, you know, doxycycline? Okay. So can we go for, say, probably other analgesic? Okay.
It's like a flow chart.
And then you come with a plan.
You mean like a flow chart? Yes. And not,
yeah. So it's just like a kind of a flow chart, where, you know, each of those particular tools are processed from one step to the other step. Okay, so I'll just, you know, try to tell you once you do the exercises. Okay. Okay. So if assuming that you have understood this, the most important statistics is like this. So imagine you are taking one person, taking one tissue like hand, you go deep, you've got a cell, you've got a nucleus at the center, okay? And within the nucleus, you've got a lot of chromatin, okay? And a chromatin is intercoiled like this, and it is coming up, coming out, and a bit of DNA is nothing but a gene. And that bit of DNA is like this, exon, intron, like this, okay? And then we learned, you know, depending on the type of parts that you want to sequence, then it is called as whole exome or whole genome or targeted genome or whole transcriptome shortcut sequencing. That I already told you, right? But imagine you're peeping within, you're peeping inside. So imagine a person, you know, paragliding or parachuting from space. Probably you are somewhere, you know, 10 kilometers above the sea level and you're paragliding. You just shot off. You cannot see anything until you reach, you know, 5 kilometers above the sea level. There, you can probably see that, you know, there are some gray areas like, you know, Jaipur. It might be Rajasthan, it might be Jaipur, karke, you know, you might know. Okay. But if you still come down 2 kilometers, you can see the tiny parts. Maybe 1 kilometer, you can clearly see the Hawa Mahal and all those kind of things. But if you really see and jot down to, say, 500 meters above the sea level, you can see your place, Jagatpura, Mahatma Gandhi Medical College, and then you can paraglide there. So that is what you call it as the depth. So the depth is nothing but till what optimal sequencing chemistry you really want to jot down. Okay, how much depth you really want to glorify for your sequences. Okay, so the more the depth, the better it is. Okay, so better is usually, the depth is usually measured in terms of X, 100X. 100X is ideal for whole exome sequencing. So as you could see here, you know, in a human genome, it's a 3.2 billion base pairs, right? For a haploid data set. And 1.8% is nothing but the whole exome sequences. So 1.8% of 3.2 is roughly 56 MB of sequences that are coding for the exons. Okay, so if you take this 56 MB and sequence it 100x depth, you'll get about 6 GB data for that particular read or for that particular sample. Is this clear difference? Okay, this is a very basic thing. So imagine you've got exons, you want to chop off only the exons because you want to understand what are the mutations specific for your disease, okay? Usually exons are 1.8% of your genome. So human genome is 3.2 billion base pairs. Okay. And 1.8% of 3.2 is approximating to about 56 MB. And if you really take 100x of it, okay, 100 times that particular thing, that approximates to about 6 GB of data. Is that clear? But if you really take the entire whole genome, so 3.2 billion base pairs with 100x, then that would be huge. Okay, so that would be about 320 GB. Okay, that would be huge. You know, you cannot take the entire data like this because you have data deluge. You may not really have the inherent capabilities of your server as well. Okay, so for whole genome sequence, because it constitutes both exons and introns, you need not do something like 100x. You can jot down to something like 40x coverage. So this is what 6.4 times 40x. 6.4 is for deployed genome. Okay, and then that comes to about 24 GB, which is okay, which is still okay. But for targeted genome, it depends, okay? It depends on the size of it. It might be as small as 10 MB or 15 MB or 20 MB, okay? That you need not really worry. So this targeted genome sequencing is also called as ampliseq, okay? But for whole transcriptome sequencing, because for whole transcriptome, you're checking the gene expression. You're not really counting the bases. You're not really looking into, probably you're not really looking into the mutations. You're only interested to identify what are those genes that are probably differentially expressed, that are upregulated or downregulated. Okay, is that clear? So for that, the number of mappable reads, the number of transcripts that are read or expressed n number of times is really taken into question. It's not really the depth, okay? So for that, the 50 million mappable reads is an ideal thing for humans, okay? So which means if you get 50 million reads from the cDNA expression, that indicates that your entity is absolutely ideal, okay? So just imagine you're sleeping, you're paragliding somewhere from the outer space. So you're digging deep into your cell, okay? And you really want to see the average depth at which you can reach consensus, you know, for better curation, okay? So that is, a kind of a statistics, you know, that this slide would really talk about, okay? Is this clear?
Yeah, but are depth and coverage the same thing?
Yes, the depth and the depth of the coverage is what we call in scientific terms, it's the same thing. Yes, yeah. Yeah, so the depth and coverage are used in the same context, but you know, it depends. You know, for example, you don't talk about the depth, you know, you don't talk about the coverage in terms of the whole transcriptome shotgun sequence, okay? You don't even talk about depth, you only talk about the number of mappable reads or the transcripts, okay? So sometimes you know, depth and coverage are interchangeable, okay? So although it is called as the depth of the coverage, okay? And of course, as I told you, the difference between reference and de novo, that is how it is. So for a clinical exome, anywhere between right from isolating your DNA till data analysis, it might take anywhere between 24 to 48 days, okay? So in case of exons, you may not really sequence the non-coding RNAs, okay? And structural variants or mitochondrial DNA, they're all missed, okay? So that is the fallacy with exons or exomes or whole exome sequencing. But you'll find those variants that are benign. Benign are those variants that are not pathogenic. You'll find mutations that are well-defined. You'll find a lot of malignant mutations, disease-associated or causal or bona fide, okay? But in any case, as I told you, for whole exome sequencing, you might end up with false positives. Unless otherwise your depth of coverage is 100x, okay? But people have even done, you know, a coverage of 500x as well, 600x as well, because the cost is really coming down, actually. So then they felt that since the cost is coming down, why not we really do whole genome sequencing? Because in whole genome sequencing, you get both introns and exons. But usually whole exome sequencing is usually done ideally if you really want to identify the mutations of interest for your known diseased phenotype, for your known diseased condition. Okay. So it is basically a kind of a diagnostic front. It's a discovery tool for diagnostics, where you can identify the mutations that are present for that particular disease. Okay. So we have developed our own pipeline, which is downloaded over 30,000 times. We still keep getting a lot of emails every day to send this particular paper and pipeline. So this pipeline, we'll be using it, which we have benchmarked across different tools, which I'll try to give you a demo. And you'll also run it through our servers. Okay. And likewise for RNA-seq also, we have benchmarked our pipeline and we have recently published here. Okay. So we use Cufflinks pipeline for this, for which I'll try to explain. So I think that finishes my 1 hour talk, but I'm just try to conclude here that if you have a reference, that's well and good, but if you don't have a reference, you can do de novo. There are some nerdy people where even though there are reference-based genomes, people really want to explore de novo, that can also be exploited. Okay. For mapping these sequences to your reference, there are two important tools like Bauti and HiSeq, and also Burrows with Elena. There is no big difference between Bauti and HiSeq, but HiSeq is more specific because it checks the spliced alignments. So when we say spliced alignments, imagine this is your sequence and this is your reference. So what happens is, if this sequence is really matching to your reference like this, okay? Imagine the same copy of this particular sequence might be present somewhere here as well. Okay, like this. So this can be exploited using HiSeq2. So HiSeq2 is more sensitive when compared to Bauti2. So the spliced alignments across several copies can be checked using HiSeq2 as well. Okay, so as I told you, raw reads and FASTQ to reference mapping, SAM tools to BAM, then you need to sort out. Then you have some tools like MPILAB, and then you call the variants in case of whole exome sequencing or whole genome sequencing or whole transcriptome shotgun sequencing. So if you have installed WinSCP or PuTTY, I'll try to demonstrate. And this is how you need to log in, SSH test at this is IP address. Okay, I'll give you the password orally and not type in. This is all security. And please, if you don't know any commands, please don't do any commands. Better don't do any exercises, but I'll try to help you. And today is not the last day for these exercises. We will go through during the next 12 days as well. Okay, so don't think that if you're not getting any results, if you're not understanding this, this is not the end of the day. We are here to explain you everything. Okay, so please, please, please don't scratch your head. Please keep asking questions. Please keep asking questions. So the main point, as I told you, is the whole exome or genome. You need to call the variants. You can identify SNPs. So what if they are falling in non-coding? Then you may apply the targeted genome sequencing or amplicon sequencing. We can do whole transcriptome or de novo transcriptome or metagenome or metatranscriptome as well. In case of whole transcriptome, you find the expression. In case of targeted genome sequencing, you can identify the interface between exons and transcripts. Okay. And then you might come up with heuristics, and then you can improve the quality of your de novo assembly as well sometimes. Okay. And of course, a very pertinent question that you really want to use is, you have assembled the genome. Is it the end of the day? Okay. You don't really call it as the end of the day because you need to improve your genome every time. Okay. So what I'm doing is, Kiran, if you can allow me, I'll use microphone from this laptop, which I am talking now, and use my desktop for sharing the screen.
I think that should be okay. But probably before you start hands-on, you want to give some break?
A quick 1 minute, please. Huh? Yeah, thank you.
No, I mean,
any questions, I'll be happy to answer.
Yeah.
I'll be happy to answer. Yeah, the popularity is because that's really kind of a good question. Nanopore, Oxford Nanopore, people are, you know, still, you know, trying hard and fast, you know, to understand Oxford Nanopore. I really don't know why, because the library preparation is a bit stringent, not so that sensitive. Illumina is user-friendly. Even a person who has not really prepared the library preparation can easily do Illumina. A PacBio is, you know, long reads of sequences, blasting them, finding the simpler sequences is a kind of a big headache. Okay. And usually, of course, you know, as you rightly pointed out, the plant sequences are usually nurtured through this long read sequencing chemistry. Because you really don't look into whole exomes in plants, you know, although people have just started doing it. And Shravana asks how de novo sequencing differs from reference genome. As I told you, Shravana, de novo is for those things where you can say that you don't have a reference. Okay, then the algorithm will go for fast approximation based approach. So it checks itself, saying that maybe this region might be similar to that of, you know, that sequence. Whereas a reference-based chemistry is nothing but you have an ideal reference for that. Okay. Any questions? Yeah. So we'll just take a quick break. So it's 6:10 in my time, India time. So we will meet at 6:14 if everyone agrees. Yeah. Thank you. You can stop the recording, Kiran. Thank you.
Yeah. Sure. Thanks.